Okay, let's look at key exchange methods. And with this, what we want is to make sure that Bob and Alice can communicate using a shared key. So it's likely they'll use symmetric key encryption. So what we want to do is for them to openly communicate even while Eve is listening, and for them to end up with the same shared key. Okay, so the basic methods that we have include the Diffie-Hellman method and the elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman method, along with public key exchange. But first, we'll look at some of the issues related to key exchange methods. The first is forward secrecy. And with this, we need to make sure that if any elements of the key is released, then all of the previous keys that were related to it could also be released. We also need to make sure that we have ephemeral keys. And with this, we do not use the same, we will not generate the same encryption keys given the same set of parameters involved in the key exchange. So let's look at the core methods that we can use. One of the most fundamental methods that we have is what's called the Diffie-Hellman method, or DH, Diffie-Hellman key exchange. And with this, what we do is we use discrete logarithms. And discrete logarithms are in the form g to the power of x mod n, where g is a generator and mod is a prime number. So with discrete logs, what we do is that we will take Alice and Bob, and they will agree to use G and N. So before the key handshake, they will agree on those two parameters. Then Alice will generate a random value A, and Bob will generate a random value B. Alice passes G to the power of A mod N, and Bob sends over G to the power of B mod N. And because of the difficulty that we have with discrete logs, Bob cannot determine A and Alice cannot determine B. So we'll call that big A and big B there. Then Alice will take the value she received and raise it to the power of A mod N. And on the other side, Bob will take Alice's value and raise it to the power of B mod N. And because that's G to the power of B to the power of A mod N, and this is G to the power of A to the power of B mod N, because of the magic of this operation here, we can still operate on these things in the same mathematical way as we would without them. So that becomes g to the power of AB mod N because of Napier's rule on logarithms, and that's also a to the power of b mod n. We then use an agreed key derivation function, and we should end up with the same key on either side. And even though Eve has been listening to the communications, she will not be able to calculate the key that Bob and Alice end up with. And each time we could go through this, we will generate a new key called a session key, and each time we will recreate the values of A and B for the session. Unfortunately, the method struggles a little bit in that Eve could be in the middle, and if we don't authenticate, then Eve can pass through the values on either side. So the method suffers from an Eve in the middle attack, where she could negotiate keys on either side with Bob and Alice, and Bob and Alice would never know that Eve was in between. Okay, so that's the Diffie-Hellman method. An improved method, and a method that we often use, is with elliptic curve methods. Or EC. With this, we have a curve such as in the form of this, where we have an A value, a B value, P value for the prime, and then that leads to our curve. And the curve itself has a base point called the G. So overall, we end up with a curve defined by A, B, G, P, and also a value called N. N is called the order, and it's the number of points that we have on the curve. So this defines our curve, and typical curves are curve 25519, sept256k1, as used in Bitcoin. The elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman method uses the same method, but rather than using discrete logs, it will use a multiplicative operation. So if we go back to Bob and Alice again, and this time generate an A and a B value, we take the base point on the curve. So if we have a curve, say there's the base point, then we add G a number of times, such as A times, and we end up with AG, which is a point on the curve here. So G added to itself A times gives us our public key value, which is the value that that Bob and Alice will exchange. So Alice sends AG mod P, and Bob will send BG. Then Alice will multiply the value she receives by A, and Bob will do the same, and they should end up with A B G. And again, they'll put that into a key derivation function, and they'll end up with the same key. Because this is a point on the elliptic curve, typically what we do is that we take the x point. So if we end up with a point, we will take the x coordinate on either side, and then we'll put it into a key derivation function from that. So this is the elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman method here. If we look back now at the Diffie-Hellman method that we have, we need to understand about how we select the G value. or the generator point. And really it relates to the prime number that we're going to select, and that we cannot select just any value of g for a given prime number. Typical values of g are 2, 3, and 5. So they're quite small values, but when we raise it to the power of this random number here, they will actually end up being extremely large. If we take an example, say, of a g and a prime number. So if we take prime number of 11, and now we take a g value of 2, and we work out for each value of x, we're going to get, if we take g equals to 2, then we end up, so it'll be 2 to the power of 2 mod n, which is mod of 11. This is that n value here. Then we end up with 4. If I complete them all, what you should see is that the values will always be within the range 0 to n minus 1. So we try 6 and we end up with 9. And then we try 7, and I think that's 3. And then 8 becomes, so that should be 7, and then 3. And then 9 becomes 6, and then 10 becomes 1. And then what happens after that, when we get to 11, is that we'll go back to here again. So what we can see is that we get a unique mapping from our x to our value that we have here. And then it will repeat after that. But if we now try another value, and I think if we use g equal to 3, what happens is that we'll see 9 and 5 and 4, 1, and then 3, 9, 5, 4. And the one thing to notice here is that this is repeating. Before it gets to the full range of the x values that we have in here. So it's important to understand that not all values of the generator will work, and that we need to create a generator which will give us the full range of outputs and a unique output for all of our values up to the value of n minus 1. You can see there's 1, and then we should have 2, 3, 4, and so on. And this will go through the sequence where this one shows repeated values. The other important thing that we have when we're looking at the Diffie-Hellman method is that we have the strength of the key exchange. These are often defined in terms of the group number, and when we use an OpenSSL, we will typically create one with a DH parameters and then define a key size to be able to create the parameters required for G and N. Okay, so if we have a connection, say it's a VPN connection or something, we will create our G and N for that. What we shouldn't do is to use a default value, because an intruder could have pre-computed many of the values that we're going to have if they know the G and the N value that we're going to have. And these will often time out after a certain amount of time. So the groups that we have, and we often start with group one, which is 768 bits. This is at the limit of what can be cracked on the internet, so we shouldn't really use this value here if we can. So we go up to group two and group five, then we're looking at 1024 bits, and group five is 1536 bits for the prime number here. And this will give us our strength of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange method. Okay, and the third method that we can use, if we just move Bob, the fourth method we can use is to use public key encryption. So one method is to use RSA to be able to exchange the key. Okay, so in these two methods we're using the key exchange, Diffie-Hellman, and we expand to elliptic curve. This one is different. In this case, what happens is that Bob will send over his public key. Alice will take the key and then encrypt with Bob's public key and pass it back. Bob will then use his private key to be able to decrypt the key and end up with the same key on either side. This method, though, suffers from forward secrecy. If someone was to discover Bob's private key, then all of the previous keys which had been encrypted with his private key, with his public key, could now be revealed and will reveal all the key exchanges. So this is such a problem that in TLS 1.2 this was supported, but in TLS 1.3 this has been deprecated, and that it's not possible to use this key exchange method. Okay, so that's been an outline of the different key exchange methods that we have. If you're interested, curve 25519 uses a base point with x equals 9. So we looked at the different weaknesses that we have, the Diffie-Hellman method, the elliptic curve method, how we create our G and N value for Diffie-Hellman, and also the RSA method. Okay, thank you.